This is ODAT Chat, your instant connection to recovery and community, one day at a time. This podcast may contain strong language, sexual content, and spiritual truth. Listener discretion is advised.
Hey friends, welcome to another episode of the ODAT Chat podcast. In case you're new here, my name is Arlena and I'll be your host. This is a podcast where my guests share their stories of alcoholism and addiction and their journey to recovery. For information on today's episode and access to past episodes, visit odatchat.com. And ODAT stands for One Day at a Time. So today my conversation is with Dr. Stephanie Covington. She's the author of A Woman's Way Through the 12 Steps, which is the book I've used to take women through the steps for about 10 years now. And it's the foundation of the step work calls I publish on the podcast. But before we jump in, I wanted to share that in order to help as many women as I can, I'm hosting a free workshop called Sobriety Reset. It starts on December 12th, and you can sign up at sobrietyreset.com. We're using Dr. Covington's book and worksheets to do this 12 steps in 6 weeks. So if you don't like AA meetings and you still need connection and support, please join us. Right now, we have about 200 women signed up, so I'm really excited to be a witness to all the transformations. So back to the episode with Dr. Covington. She is an internationally recognized clinician, author, organizational consultant, and lecturer. She is a pioneer in the field of women's issues, addiction, trauma, and recovery. She's developed an innovative, gender-responsive, and trauma-informed approach that results in effective services in public, private, and institutional settings. Dr. Covington's clients include the Betty Ford Treatment Center, the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment in Washington, D.C., the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, and numerous other treatment and correctional settings. Dr. Covington was a workshop chair for the Women's Treatment Improvement Protocol published by the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. You know what? There was a lot of other things that she had listed on her website, and I thought maybe we would just talk to her and find out more about what she does. She has had such a profound impact on me personally and the women who I have had the honor to sponsor over the years. So super grateful for her time today. So with that, please enjoy this episode with Dr. Stephanie Covington. All right. Well, what do I call you Dr. Covington?
You call me Stephanie. Okay. You want to introduce me as Dr. Covington, but don't call me that all hour long. It'll be
okay.
Weird.
It'll be weird.
Okay. Creepy.
Okay, let's not be creepy. No. Awesome. Well, Dr. Stephanie Covington, thank you so much for joining me on the ODAT Chad podcast.
Thank you for inviting me.
I'm so excited. So as we were just chatting, I have 120 women so far signed up to go through the 12 steps in 6 weeks using your book. I'm so excited.
Yeah, that sounds great. I'm going to want to hear all about it.
Yeah, I'll call you when as we progress and okay. Let you know how we're doing. But they are so excited that I'm actually talking to you today. So and, you know, I have been publishing what I call step work calls with several women, and I've been publishing them as podcast episodes, and we've been using your worksheets, and they have been amazing. Those episodes get a higher response than any of the other interviews that I do. So I'm really excited to be talking to you. And, you know, at the outset, I just want to say thank you so much for writing this book. How long ago did you write that?
You know, that book was published, I think, in 1994, which means it's old.
It's almost 26 years old, right?
Isn't that something?
So I got sober in 94.
Yeah.
So wow.
And so it takes usually a couple of years to write something. By the time you write it and you get the manuscript done, you send it to the publisher, it's another year. So it was in the early 90s, really. But it was published in 94. And wow. It's... I looked at it recently, and because every now and then publishers say, do you want to update something or do a new edition? You know, there really isn't anything in there I would change. You know?
Listen, it is so good.
It works.
It works, yeah.
And women in all parts of the country use it, other countries. So I haven't had any complaints, if you will, about why don't you update it or this feels tired or whatever. Uh-huh. And no, so I'm not changing it, not at this point.
Mm-mm. No, I wouldn't change it. It's working. I mean, so I have a sponsor who introduced me to the workbook probably 8 to 10 years ago. And I had already been sober for probably 15 years at the time. I'm not great with math, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It had been a stretch, and I found the worksheets to be helpful for me to experience the steps in a different way, right? Because it's easy to get caught in a rut and have established thought patterns. So to look at the steps from a different perspective was hugely helpful. And I've been having girls I sponsor, you know, since I started using them, they use the workbook too, because I find that it's sort of, and it's written in a way, you know, the big book and the text I love, but it's also very male oriented. Yeah.
Well, yeah. And the whole idea is, I don't know if you know that for, 20 years, World Services has talked about getting rid of the sexist language in the big book, and it gets voted down every time. And that's part of what motivated me, was all these years, that discussion. I thought, I think I need to write something for women, because I think there's something about having female pronouns and women's stories and women's perspective that resonates with us differently. And this idea of just translate it didn't seem right for me. So I decided there need to be something with women's stories, women's voices. And I think that's why it resonates with women.
Absolutely. Yeah, you really struck a nerve. I mean, I know women sometimes early in sobriety who will go through the whole book and scratch out he and write her, you know, that whole exercise. It just seems like
the translation.
Yeah. So, but yes, so thank you for writing the book and the workbook. I have found it to be hugely helpful in my own recovery and the recovery of the women that I sponsor. So thank you. Yeah.
You're amazing.
Okay. But just to take a little step back, I'm so curious about you. Like, how does somebody get from, you know, I don't even know where you came from to where you are now, because where you are now, how did you get here?
It's always a question.
I know it's a big question, right? But I'm usually so curious about people's upbringing. How has addiction affected your life? Did you come from parents with drinking issues? I believe you mentioned that you yourself were in recovery. So maybe you can kind of give me a little background.
Sure. I'll go quickly. I grew up in Southern California, had not a difficult life, and went to college here, went to graduate school in New York, married a New Yorker, and drinking was very much part of our life. He was a Wall Street person, and so that was our social life, included a lot of wine and after-dinner drinks and, you know, cocktail and all that rigmarole. And so very clearly I had a problem with alcohol, and got into recovery, mother of two kids, married two kids, living on the East Coast, and also knew when I got into recovery that I wanted a divorce, and got divorced and came back to Southern California.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Did you get divorced right away, or did you wait like the year?
No, well, they told me to wait a year.
Oh, you followed instructions?
No. You don't make any major changes the first year.
That's what they say.
Let's see. I got divorced. I gave up the business I was in. I moved back to Southern California. I got, you know, and everything changed.
Everything in the first year.
Everything. Mm-hmm. They tell you not to do that.
Right.
I always thought it's because, well, maybe you make bad decisions, which I think is possible. For me, what I realized when all the sort of dust settled is it was so stressful. And I felt like I got back here in California, got through that process, which wasn't simple. And I felt like I'd put my finger in an electric socket. I just was, and I thought, it's too much. You know, I should have waited. You know, it was just too much change. Lot of it was good. And fine, but even good change is stressful.
Yeah.
And so it was just, that wasn't my hindsight. Could have slowed that down a little bit. Could have slowed that down, but I didn't.
Those are big changes, moving from the East Coast back to the West Coast, divorce,
becoming
everything.
A single parent, you know, I mean, just everything.
Came with you, I would imagine. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How old were your kids at that time?
My kids were 8 and 11.
Okay, so that was probably hard on them. Did they go back and forth to visit dad and stuff?
My son was here for a year, and he went back and lived with his dad for a couple of years. Then it came back again. Okay. And the kids did go visit, but my son went and stayed and then came back in high school.
Okay.
So in the process of getting into recovery, I realized my parents had a drinking. When I was drinking, I hadn't noticed it. But when
funny.
Because I drank with them. We that was part of what we did.
You drank and, like them?
Yeah. And then when I stopped, it was like, oh my. And they didn't drink in my childhood, but they clearly each had an alcohol problem. And finally, I convinced my sister that we would do an intervention. And my parents at age 80 went into treatment.
80.
Mm-hmm. And into recovery at age 80.
How did they do? Did they do okay?
They did great.
That's amazing.
Yep. They'd been drinking for years. They went into treatment. They did not have a slip, a relapse. And I can tell you that it changed the quality of their last years. I'm so grateful. Changed our, of course, you know, family events got easier. And I used to be afraid that my dad would drive after they'd been drinking. Oh, it's just scary. Yeah. So their last years were in recovery, which...
That's really cool.
Right. Which was
that's amazing.
We were all very grateful. Very grateful. Yeah. So, May, you know, it's never too late. Why would you do that? I didn't necessarily think it would work. It's just that we needed to do one more thing. You know, it's the one thing we hadn't done. That's right. How I explained to my sister, we've done this. We've talked to them. We've done this. I said, we have to do this. And she said, oh, my. But she did it with me. We did it on a Saturday, and by Tuesday or Wednesday of the next week, they were in treatment.
Did they do like a traditional 30-day inpatient treatment?
My mother went inpatient. My dad was out. Well, what happened is there's no place in the country that will take a couple inpatient. And the reason is because when they've done it, the couple, they sneak out and have sex. I didn't think we were at high risk. I said,
at 80? I don't know.
I don't think it's an issue. I don't know, but I don't think so. So my mother went inpatient and my dad was outpatient. Same program, one inpatient, one outpatient. And
that is amazing. How long had you been sober when they went into treatment?
Oh, that's the hard question.
It was after your divorce.
I was probably 20, 25 years in recovery by the time they got into treatment.
How long have you been sober now?
40 years.
Wow. Wow. Girl, you look fabulous.
Well, I can't say I didn't go into recovery at 12.
Wow.
Yeah. So I've had it's been a long journey.
Long journey.
Changed my life. As you well know. I mean, recovery gives you an opportunity to totally transform your life.
And I got to tell you, I'm an obsessive learner, And there has been nothing that I have found that is as transformative as the 12 steps. And I'm going through a process. Have you ever heard of Big Book Awakening? It's really intense. And it took me several months to complete step one because I was so resistant to all the work that was required. I thought it was stupid. I was super arrogant, you know, 25 years sober. I know some things. But it's an amazing process. I have come to grips with my insanity in areas that I was blind to. You know, it's the funny thing about denial is, you know, stands for don't even know I'm lying, right? Mm-hmm. And how do you see what you can't see,
right?
And for me, going through the process, and they told me this when I was brand new sober too, that if you work the steps will work you,
yes,
you know, a spiritual program and all that. Was that your experience when you yourself took the 12 steps?
Yeah, I think for me, the 12 steps are the transformative part of recovery, not the big book. It's,
yeah,
I mean, it's the 12 steps. And I really do believe they're tools for living, that yeah, we use them in terms of addiction, but they're really fabulous guidelines in lots of situations. And I can think of many times, including currently, where I thought, you know, if the world operated on the 12 steps, we'd be in a very different place.
Oh my goodness. Yes. Think about it. Seriously.
Yeah. What if politicians were using 12 steps?
That's exactly what I was thinking as soon as you said that.
Yeah, right. Think about it.
Yeah.
So different. It's a whole different way of seeing the world and behaving in the world. So to me, it's the steps that are the transformative.
Yeah, just magical. So when you got into recovery, did you do a treatment center?
No, I didn't even know there were treatment centers.
Oh, me either.
I didn't know there was. I just had a bad experience. And for whatever reason, the next morning, I got on the phone and I looked up Alcoholics Anonymous and called and found where there was a meeting. I have no idea what motivated me.
That is wild. Like you went through in the yellow pages or something.
Exactly. Yeah. In the old yellow pages.
And was there someone local and they directed you to a meeting in your neighborhood?
Somebody answered the phone. I don't know who. Somebody answered the phone. And I asked, and they told me, and I called on a Saturday, and they told me where there was a meeting. I don't know if it was that day or the next day. And I went. So I go to my first meeting, right? And, you know, people say hello, and then they introduce me to this woman who then became my sponsor. And then afterwards, she was talking to me about, you know, not drinking. I said, well, no, that's not why I'm here. I'm really not here to stop drinking. I just want to drink and not have any difficulties. She said, well, you might find that stopping is how you know. And then she said, it must have been a Saturday, because she said coming back the next day to another meeting she told me about. I said, I don't know if I can. It's my anniversary. And she said, the best thing you can do for your relationship is go to another meeting.
Wow.
That was really interesting, you know, but I didn't go thinking I needed to stop.
So you had no preconceived notions of what AA was about, or?
I knew it was for people who were alcoholics.
Uh-huh.
That's basically what I knew. I'm so curious about
you said you had a bad experience and called the next day. Do you want, what kind of bad experience? Was it like a car crash kind of bad experience?
It was one of those horrible, my daughter was going to have a birthday, and so we were delivering birthday invitations to her friends, not putting them in the mail. And some friends said, oh, why don't you stay and have dinner? And I did. And the next morning when I woke up, I couldn't remember how I got home. I didn't remember where my daughter was. I had a cut across my face. I didn't know how I got it. I felt awful. And when my son got up, he showed me how I was the night before.
What do you mean? How did he show you?
He showed me how drunk I was. I had to hold on to furniture in the wall. And it turns out I fell down. Old house that had front stairs and back stairs, and I had fallen down the back steps going up to the bedroom. And I just thought, that's it.
All done. And that was your last drink?
Well, no, about a month later, someone had given me a bottle of champagne for my birthday. It was in the refrigerator. And I thought, you know, this is silly to let that go to waste. I'll just have one glass of champagne.
Right.
Well, that didn't turn out very well. And that was it.
And that was it.
That was it. That was probably about a month later. And I just thought, obviously I can't manage this.
Right. Yeah.
There is no one. There was never one.
And I think what is the common experience is that terrible feeling, right? It doesn't matter what the specific circumstances were. It's like the feelings are all the same. Just that incomprehensible demoralization that they talk about in the big book, of the shame, the guilt.
Yeah. Very, very shameful. And I was frightened, you know. I mean, it was, I think, to not know where you've been, what you've done.
I'm familiar.
Yeah. I mean, I certainly had plenty of that previously, but I think the fact that it was also connected to my kids.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Women have a lot of shame when it comes to being a mom, you know, this idea of we want to be a good mother, and the idea that we might not be is so crushing. It's devastating to think that, you know, I do something that might hurt my kids or make me a bad mom.
Horrible. There's so much mother guilt, just generally.
I know.
Mother guilt's pervasive. And then you have an addiction problem, you have a drinking problem, and you break your own value system. The thing you say you won't do, you do. And you think, I never would do that, but you do.
Yeah.
And it is, it's just demoralizing.
Yeah, very demoralizing. Well, listen, and it's so interesting too, because this is all happening past graduate school. And were you already a doctor by then?
No, I had a master's degree in social work from Columbia. I had lived in California, went to New York, went to Columbia, got my social work degree, married, did all this stuff. And then when I came back to California, I went back to school to get my PhD because I drank all through my master's program and I didn't know if I knew anything.
Hilarious.
I didn't know.
Funny?
I think if I go back to school, I'll see if my brain works. I'll see if I know anything, you know, because I drank all through graduate school.
Isn't that something? So you got your PhD after you got sober.
Yeah.
Very cool. And when did you start getting into recovery work? Did you do it right from the outset after you got your PhD?
Yeah, well, I knew when I was working on my PhD, I was very clear that I wanted to work with women with addictive disorders. That was really my goal.
Yeah.
And so I had I did some work in a treatment program, actually a couple of treatment programs as I was going to school. And my dissertation focused on women with addictive disorders. And then I opened a private practice and, you know, you say you specialize in that, but think how few people call a therapist and say, I think I have an addiction problem.
So what do they come
from? Well, they come because they're depressed, or they come because they have relationships falling apart,
relationship
having trouble with their kids, or, you know, and then you listen and very often it's a problem with alcohol.
I can't tell you how many times I've sat in a room of Alcoholics Anonymous where they talk about how they paid somebody $200 an hour to lie to them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And it's just, you know, it's the denial, right? It's very difficult to break through the denial.
Yeah.
Until
so I started doing that. And then I started going, I also was going to conferences, addiction conferences, to learn. And I realized I didn't talk much about women at all. So I'd go to a conference that wouldn't really be much on women. So then I'd write a proposal for the next year's conference and say, I want to talk about this. And so I started speaking about women, women's issues, just all sort of moved along.
You saw the need and decided to step in.
Yep.
That's so amazing. And you know, when I see a lot of people, early recovery, it's like when the denial starts to lift and you start having all these epiphanies, and your life starts getting better, like the level of suffering comes down, your self-esteem comes up, your life gets better. You're like, oh my God, everybody needs to know this stuff.
Right.
And, you know, I do that too. It's like, I want to save the world.
Well, you know, it's, I think once we have this kind of a life change, it's hard not to want to share it.
Yeah, it really is. One thing I have never talked about on the podcast is women's sexuality in recovery. And, you know, I talk a lot about your the women's way through the 12 steps, but what I saw when I did some research about, you know, the kind of work that you do, and I saw this Awakening Your Sexuality, A Guide for Recovering Women. You know, one of the things I bump up against all the time that I don't know how to navigate is there are so many women in recovery who are survivors of sexual abuse.
Yes.
Like they say, like in the general population, 1 out of 4 women have experienced some sort of sexual assault. But I don't know the numbers, and this is not based on anything other than my own guessing. So obviously not scientific, but I would almost say in the rooms of recovery, it's the opposite. I would say it's only 1 in 4 women who have not been sexually abused.
Yeah, you'd be closer. Yeah, in fact, that was part of what my dissertation was for my PhD.
Really?
Yeah, I was looking at a comparative study between alcoholic and non-alcoholic women in terms of sexual dysfunction, sexual experience, and sexual abuse. Because what I began to see in my practice was so many women had these abuse histories.
Yeah.
And for many of them, they'd started to use because of that.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that was very linked. And treatment programs wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole.
Was that the sexual abuse?
Yeah.
They won't talk about it?
Well, they do now better. But in the years ago, we would know this, and I would say something at a conference. He said, well, yeah, but people can deal with their sexual abuse issues when they've been clean and sober for a year. And I would say, well, for some of them, the connection is such that they're not going to get a year, you know? And they'd say, oh, no, you're just trying to excuse their addiction. No, I'm not trying to excuse it, but I think you have to look at all the pieces in a woman's life. And so a lot of my work has been working with women who have trauma histories. And so, you know, I've written the 12-step book, but I've also written program materials, and all of them talk about trauma, all of them.
Yeah. And I wanted to ask you, I'm going to kind of jump around a little bit, but I'll come back. But I noticed that a lot of your literature and stuff that I saw online was about, you know, healing trauma and, trauma-informed services, which was a new term for me. So can you explain what trauma-informed services are?
Sure. And the kind of levels to this. So
okay.
When people become trauma-informed, it means they learn about and have knowledge about trauma. They understand what it is and what typical responses are and so forth. And then there's trauma responsive, is where we try to get programs to learn this material and then adjust their policies and their practices to take it into account. And then trauma specific is when there's an actual intervention for the people being served. So, you know, a lot of people get education in trauma and they'll bring a program into their treatment program, but they don't change any of their policies and practices. So let me give you some examples, okay? A women's residential program. And what they do at night is they do bed checks by opening the door and shining in a flashlight to see if she's in bed. Now think about what that experience would be like for a woman who's a trauma survivor who might have been sexually abused as a child.
Oh my God, I got the flat. I mean, I've heard so many stories. So as soon as you said that, oh my God, Stephanie, that's terrible.
Terrible. So we want people to change their policies and their practices. Here's what you learn. Now, once you know this, here's what you need to do. And okay, we also so need to provide services for the women who've had these experiences. So there's levels to the work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Levels to the work. So trauma-informed practices, you learn this and then you work differently.
Change policy.
Through the lens. Change policies and practice. Earlier, you and I, before we started the podcast, were talking about the women in prison.
Yes.
Okay, think about a woman in prison who has an abuse history, and they shackle her, they restrain her.
Oh, my God.
Okay, so she's totally re-traumatized.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's getting those places, too, to change what they do. not easier said than done, but that's a lot of the work that I do.
Ah, that makes me want to cry.
Can you imagine? It's awful.
It's awful. And I don't know what the solution to that is, because I know here's the other thing is a lot of women are really angry.
Oh yeah. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I'm sure you see it. You do work at prisons and things like that, and they're pissed off, rightly so. But it's like, I've seen plenty of shows on cops where the women are super violent and stuff, and so they need to be restrained for the safety of the officers and for themselves. But you're right. It's like re-traumatizing. I don't understand. What's the path forward from there?
Yeah. Well, we try to train officers to understand about trauma. And actually, I have a treatment program called Beyond Violence. It's for women who commit violent, aggressive crimes. Okay. And I work with them on the violence they've experienced as well as the violence they've perpetrated. And have them look at their anger. And, you know, some people don't realize that their anger really comes from these abusive experiences they've had, and that wasn't safe to be angry.
It wasn't safe to be angry. Yeah, the level of detachment. Mm-hmm. It's like I see so many women who, like, I just had a conversation with a sponsee yesterday where she was telling me that she feels worse now that she's sober. And I'm like, of course you feel worse. You're finally in touch with your pain. you're having a feeling. Right. Yeah, they're not all going to be good. These are growing pains, and you learn to adjust, and your balance, emotional balance is restored in time. But
that's what alcohol and drugs do. It numbs us out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, for some women, it was a solution to a problem, and then the solution became a problem. Yeah. And so we have to have other ways. People have to have other ways to comfort themselves, soothe themselves, other than using drugs.
Absolutely. And I'm so curious about, like, I'm very pragmatic. I love the 12 steps. I love practical, actionable steps. And I'm wondering, I want to circle back to the awakening your sexuality, because that sounds so interesting. But for somebody who is, and maybe this relates to that, because like, I don't know how to, listen, I'm not a professional. I would send somebody to a professional, but how does somebody work through that sexual trauma? Do they have to go to therapy and talk about what actually happened, or?
Yeah, well, some of the work can begin without ever talking about what happened. So people think you have to go. Yeah, the way I've written the programs, I have two predominant programs about trauma, and set it up so that women can be in groups with each other, and they don't have to discuss the event in order to begin the healing process. And that allows many women to sign up and do the work.
Yeah, so that's amazing.
And then what really happens in group is the women feel safer and safer with each other. They often share what happened, but it's not a requirement ever.
Okay. What if one lady shares her experience before somebody else is ready to hear it?
Well, one of the things we teach are coping mechanisms. I mean, that's really the key to trauma healing, is that if you're triggered by a sight, a sound, a smell, something in the environment, somebody else's story, you have to have tools to comfort yourself if you're feeling emotionally overwhelmed.
Okay.
So we teach tools. We teach how to do that, things you can do. And they're really simple things. Really simple.
Like what?
Okay. Sometimes it's breathing.
Oh, breathing. Being present in the moment.
Being present. You're feeling overwhelmed, so you breathe deeply, like you're smelling a rose, and you breathe out through your mouth like you're blowing out a candle. So we have women learn to do that, breathing in like smelling a rose, breathing out like blowing out a candle. Or sometimes I have little bubble, you know, those old bubble things. Bubble wands. And so blowing bubbles is another way to learn how to breathe.
Wow.
Teach them things like, there's an exercise called the five senses exercise. And if you do this in your mind, you can do it while I'm talking to you. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So I want you to name to yourself where you are, five things you can see.
Out loud or just in my mind?
Just in your mind.
Okay. It's a podcast.
I know it'll be weird. Well, it's
not too much sense. I was thinking cell phone, laptop, coffee mug. Okay.
Four things you can touch.
Four things I can touch. Okay.
Okay. Three things you can hear.
Okay.
Got it. Two things you can smell.
Okay.
And one thing you can taste.
Okay.
Okay. So what this is, it's a simple little thing that gets someone right in the present moment. Wow. And in the present moment, you're safe.
Yes.
As part of being triggered by having a sight, a sound, a smell, somebody's story, is you take it in, and if you're a trauma survivor, it can push you back in time, triggering memory from the past, and you're flooded by the feelings that belong back here.
Right.
But what if you can get yourself into the here and now, then you're okay.
Okay. And when you're back to the here and now, is there a way to, because I did something called process therapy. I don't know if you've ever heard of that, but the idea was that I had the opportunity to like bring up something, and then she and I would do work together to resolve it so that it didn't continue to, you know, I'm doing the hand motion on a podcast, but come back and smack me. Come back and smack me in the head later.
Right.
Is that a thing? Can you really resolve trauma from the past so it doesn't continue to trigger you? And
what you can do is you can learn to manage triggers. Trauma never goes away.
It doesn't.
No. Well, think about it.
That's a bummer.
Every powerful life experience stays with us all of our lives. You're going to have life experiences from 10, 20 years ago that are still with you, good or bad.
Sure.
It's the nature of life. It's just the nature of life.
Right.
So what it is not thinking I'm going to get rid of this, but how am I going to live with it and manage it so it's not managing me?
Okay.
And think about addiction.
Right.
Now, you're not actively using, but your experience of addiction is going to stay with you all your life.
Yeah. And there's a book.
That's not a bad thing.
It's not. It's the best worst thing that ever happened to me.
Exactly.
Once told me, because now I'm sensitive in a way to something that other people are not, which makes me uniquely useful.
Right. Yeah.
And that, you know, and I like that feeling of feeling useful, because it means that all that pain I had wasn't for nothing.
But every major life experience stays with us. You don't get rid of it.
Okay, I thought you were going to tell me we were going to magically.
No. But you know, there's something called post-traumatic growth.
Okay.
And post-traumatic growth is when someone has taken an experience and they're on the other side of it. Mm-hmm. You could use addiction. We could, but I would probably use some other. Some people think addiction's traumatic. It depends on the person. I don't think it is for everybody. But that then becomes a growth experience. There's something comes out of it that either you feel more gratitude in your life, you're having deeper connection with other people. There's something because of that experience that now turns into something positive. Not that I'd want anyone to have trauma in their life, but it doesn't always have to be seen as this horrible thing that I can never get past that owns me. That's what we don't want women to experience.
Right. It does feel like that we're able, I heard that we, you know, in recovery you can turn defects into assets, right? Mm-hmm. And yeah, I almost feel like these experiences can be transformed.
Absolutely.
We can reframe it. We can tell ourselves a different story about what it means, because I feel like we assign meaning to things and then we live under this story that's not necessarily true.
Mm-hmm. But even if it is true.
Yeah.
So let's take a woman who has a horrible abuse history.
Mm-hmm.
There's no reason that she cannot live a positive, full, joyful life.
Right. Once she comes to terms with how to manage her triggers.
Right.
Okay. That's very practical.
Yeah. So
I like, okay. So breathing exercise and the five senses exercise to bring you back to the present moment.
Yeah, just things that can be comforting, you know, because we do this a lot with people in early recovery because we're taking away their comfort. We're taking away the thing they've used. And if you don't help people get something else, they'll go back to what they know.
Yeah, you hear all this talk about we need a sufficient substitute, right? Something, a message that has depth and weight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But we also need some practical things.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, no, I'm a very like practical type of person. And one of the big messages you hear in 12-step rooms is the concept of a higher power or having a spiritual experience. And when you were talking about the post-traumatic growth, I think I saw an Oprah show where they were talking about near-death experiences, and I related that to my alcoholism. Mm. Like that was kind of a near-death experience for me. Mm. Times when I would drive drunk, or I'd wake up the next morning and not know what happened at all.
Right.
I'm grateful that nothing, you know,
awful.
I was going to say nothing awful happened, but I didn't like get into a car wreck and I was never mutilated. You know what I mean? Like okay. I hear
you're still alive.
Yeah, I'm alive and I'm whole and I'm healthy. Mm-hmm. But sometimes those near-death experiences are enough of a wake-up call to set you on a different path. And I feel like that's kind of what it sounds like the post-traumatic growth experiences are.
Sometimes it's not that dramatic. You know, the shift from... the shift from having a traumatic experience be a horrible 100% negative experience, that shift, sometimes it's not as dramatic as a spiritual awakening or it can be a really gradual process for a woman. You know, it's just different for different people.
Different for everyone.
Yeah.
Did you grow up with any kind of religion, or do you have a spiritual practice now? Or?
Well, my family were the kinds of families that we went to church because that was the right thing to do. My sister and I hated going to Sunday school. We would try to get out of it. I remember one time getting married, my mother said, "I'm so glad we go to that church. It just has a nice sanctuary for a while."
It'll look good for the pictures.
Yeah, exactly. So it gives you kind of a sense of religion, okay?
Right.
Yeah. So I would say no.
Okay. So no personal.
No, it was very superficial. But it's funny, but I was interested in religion and took a religions class in college and all that. Yeah. But through recovery, I got much more interested in meditation and more Eastern philosophy. And I love traveling in Southeast Asia and going to the temples. And actually, in a few weeks or a month, I guess, actually about now, I'm going to go back to India for a month. And, it's a very spiritual country. And so my spiritual practices are much more Eastern than Western.
I just recently started exploring Buddhism. Are you familiar with Tara Brach?
Yes.
Oh, I love her. I discovered her podcast. And when I can't sleep at night, I listen to her book called Radical Self-Acceptance. Mm-hmm. It's so good.
So those are the things that, you know, and that came to me out of recovery, really.
Amazing. Okay. So that's the foundation of your spiritual practice is being present and mm-hmm. being kind and loving. That's amazing. I love that. Okay. So maybe this is a hard transition.
Not necessarily.
Right. Cause when we were talking about, so I wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, the Awakening Your Sexuality, mm-hmm. a guide for recovering women. Because in the vein that we've been speaking about, like women who have traumatic sexual histories, like how do we transition to, I'll just speak for myself. When I transitioned from pre-sobriety to sobriety, like I began to have like this awareness that my sexuality was a tool for validation. Mm-hmm. Right. I confused sex and love.
Right.
Like, I thought that if I could find the right man and make him fall in love with me, then I would be okay. And if I could make enough money, then my life would be perfect. As it turns out, I was wrong. Apparently you can't, I was going to say something obscene, so you can't have sex to recovery. Like, you don't recover through a lot of sexual experiences.
You usually get into recovery because of the thing.
Yes, that was my experience. But it was so funny because I get sober and I meet this amazing man, and we've been together ever since. We've been together for almost, like, so I didn't listen to any of the advice either. I got into a relationship with someone, I was 5 months sober, but it worked out. We've stayed sober. He's just celebrated 31 years of recovery and whatever. But when I felt loved for the very first time, like, all my performance needs kind of went out the window.
Right.
And I had a period of, I wouldn't say abstinence, obviously, because I was in a relationship and I was really young. I was 25. But do you know what I'm saying? It's like I had to have this, I was in transition and it was so weird. And I didn't have any, nobody was talking about their sexuality in early recovery.
That's why I wrote the book, is because what we find is for a lot of women, there are a whole variety of sexual issues.
Yeah.
For women who are in early recovery, they usually have more sexual dysfunctions. Their bodies don't work as well as women who haven't been using alcohol and drugs. Some women have never been sexual clean and sober.
Right.
There's always been some drug involved. Some women have a lot of issues, body image issues. Some women have been sexually abused. Some women struggle with their sexual identity. Am I gay? Am I straight? Am I somewhere in between? Issues around being a sex worker. I mean, there's just a lot of issues. And then they don't talk. You could go to a 12-step meeting for 20 years and they never talk about it.
I typically go to mixed meetings, but I host an online women's meeting, but nobody ever talks about how weird sex is in the beginning.
Yeah.
My first sober sexual experience was so weird.
Yeah, because you were present.
I know. And I was in good shape. I didn't have body issues, but I was all in my head. I wasn't in my body. Mm-hmm. I was so worried about what he's thinking, what I look like, what, you know what I mean? It's like, I didn't even know what I wanted, or it was so weird.
In some ways you have to think, they talk about emotional development. You know, mm-hmm. how they talk about our emotional development is arrested at the time we start using. I think sexual development gets arrested.
Oh.
And so that in some ways, when you come into recovery, you're probably sexually younger than your years. So for me, I felt like I went through adolescence again. It wasn't particularly attractive. Adolescence isn't great when you're the right age. It's not great when you're older.
At least when you're older, you can kind of hide it a little bit better.
Maybe.
Not behind closed doors. You can't hide it.
So, but that's why I wrote the book. And then I wrote the book using about four or five different women's stories so we could follow along and see kind of what happened to them over the course of recovery.
Right.
And they were really composites of different clients and things, but just some of the issues that women struggled with because nobody talked about it.
Yeah, and I'm looking at this. I have the inside of the book cover. Mm-hmm. So I was particularly interested in parts 3 and 4. So part 3 is titled "The Power of Choice: Ongoing Recovery," and there's topics in here like choosing a new sexual life, the power to change sexual assets, moving through guilt. Gosh, that's a big one, right?
It's huge.
Guilt about, what I had done, like how I acted out sexually before I got sober, like feelings. Women are so shamed about their sexual experiences.
Yeah. Men are, women, there's so much, that's the other thing, so much guilt about what was done while under the influence.
Yeah.
and which adds to the shame that comes with the addiction to begin with for women, which women carry more shame than men do, both about parenting, both about sexuality, both addiction, all of those things. We carry more shame. And it's because society, you know, likes to put us on a pedestal and think women don't do those things.
Yeah, you should be a nice girl.
It's funny. I thought you were going to say none.
None? No, no, no. Nobody is going to confuse me for a nun. not with my body mouth. So I don't know if you have practical ways to resolve shame, but I have found that as I speak about my experiences that I was once ashamed about, like I don't have any shame anymore, I don't think, but because I can speak freely about things that I did and I don't really feel shame. You know, as a matter of fact, when I was a young girl, I decided if I couldn't be good, I was going to be good at being bad. Like Jessica Rabbit. Right. I'm not bad. I was just drawn that way. One of my favorite lines ever, but it was like, I was going to own it. Mm-hmm. If I was already bad, I decided I was going to own it. And there's like an aggressive, that's like one of the coping skills, right? Is you aggressively own your sexuality. And I see when I see young girls that are promiscuous, I go, that girl was abused. Because she's owning her sexuality in like an aggressive way. And that's what she was taught. And it's just like, it's a lack of self-respect. It breaks my heart. But as an adult, I have found peace by talking to other women, and almost like as we talk about it, it almost normalizes the experiences.
See, I think that's one of the powerful things also about 12-step work and sponsorship. Mm-hmm. And theoretically in therapy too, but there's something about the sharing and realizing you're not alone. There's a funny, maybe you remember this story, it's in the 12-step book, of the woman who had all the shame about how many men she'd slept with. And she told her sponsor, and her sponsor had her get out the phone book and look at all the names of the men she had not slept with.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
Isn't that hysterical?
That is hysterical. I don't know how I missed that.
Yeah, really, I think it's a very funny. I'm sure it's in there because it was one of the funnier stories. And I was talking about that somewhere. I was giving a talk someplace, and a woman raised her hand and she said, I'm from a very small town in Vermont. It wouldn't work.
That's gold. Oh my God, that poor woman.
But it's that kind of being able to talk about it, laugh about it, and it's not such a get rid of the heaviness of it all.
Get rid of the heaviness.
The heaviness of it all. Yeah.
Yeah. Listen, I could talk to you forever. I want to be respectful of your time. But yes, I'm doing the current workshop on a women's way, but this might have to be the next one. This is really gold. I have to really dive into this. And I feel like I'm somewhat of a sex expert, but maybe not.
Well, you might be.
I don't know.
Hopefully in your own life.
Right? Exactly. Well, this has been fascinating. And I am so grateful for the work that you do. And I encourage anyone who is curious, where is the best place to go to learn more about your work?
I think probably go to the website. It's just www.stephaniecovington.com. And the website shares, you know, what I do. It talks about what I do. It talks about what I've written. You'll see.
Yeah, listen, it's a pretty heavy duty website. I was going through it.
There's a lot on there.
You're busy.
Yeah, I'm very, yeah.
So busy. Like I was looking at all the books and all the boards that you're on, and wow, you've been very busy. So
very busy.
Yeah. Very busy. I wanted to ask you really quickly about what it must have felt like, because I understand that in the UK they named a recovery house after you, the Covington House. Was that amazing?
It was amazing. It was very sweet and very, the whole thing was very touching that they're a group of, it's a, you know, a treatment group, and they have a women's residence, and they had started using Helping Women Recover many years ago. And then I was coming there and they said, you know, we've actually never been trained. Will you come and meet us and train us? And I did that. And then, you know, I got to know them. And then they said, you know, we've decided we're renaming our treatment program to the
Covenant. Oh my God.
It was so, oh, that was so sweet.
Oh, well, listen, you have touched so many lives that you, I mean, it would be hard to express just what an impact you had on my life and the women that I work with. And I can't wait to share with you like what comes out of this 6-week workshop that we're going to do using your worksheets. And I don't know. Thank you.
I'm glad you appreciate your work. I'm glad you contacted. I'll tell you a quick thing that when I was a few weeks in recovery and I was feeling so good, I thought to myself, I want to help one other woman feel the way I do. And that's what started this whole trajectory. That thought, I want one other woman to feel the way I do. So I feel very grateful to be able to do work that I love.
Amazing. So well, thanks again. I just appreciate you so much. And thank you for your time today. And I can't wait to let you know what happens with the workshop.
Do let me know. I want to hear all about it.
I will. Thank you so much. You have a great evening.
Sure. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay.
Did we that do it? Okay, good.
So good. I got goosebumps many times.
Great.
Yeah. So I'll let you know when I, so you know what I plan to do is.
So when do you start? When do you start your group?
On the 12th. How funny is that? The 12th month, we're doing the 12 steps on the 12th day.
Perfect.
It just worked out that way. I didn't even plan it. It just happened. So that's when we start. So I'll let you know what happens.
Let me know how it goes.
I will. And I'll publish this. I want to publish this episode on the 100th. You'll be the 100th episode.
Okay, perfect.
Isn't that fun?
Yes.
Awesome. Well, it was such a pleasure to talk to you.
Okay, stay in touch. Okay.
I will. Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
One last thing before you go. If you enjoyed the podcast today, please don't forget to subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher and leave a review. And if you'd like to make a donation to the podcast and help me keep the lights on, you can do so by visiting odatchat.com. There's a donation button or membership button on the right-hand side. Have a great day. Thank you so much for joining us.